morning, everyone, again. Thank you so much for being here. So I'm so excited to talk to you a little bit more about Istio Ambient Service Mesh, particularly about how Istio Ambient Service Mesh made it easier. So a little bit of introduction about me. If you are not here in the morning, I joined Solo about 2 years ago. Prior to joining Solo, I was a senior technical staff member at IBM, and I've made a lot of contribution to Istio. I wrote 2 books about Istio. In fact, on Wednesday, we're going to have book signing about Istio Ambient Explained. So Niraj talked about Istio Ambient was launched to the community on September 7th, and particularly it's a new data plane mode for Istio without sidecar. The ztunnel architecture starts with a node network proxy, and it has traffic redirection, captures all the local traffic for co-located pods for any incoming and outgoing traffic. Here's a little bit deep dive. Let me make sure I'm not blocking you. Here's a little bit deep dive regarding ztunnel, the architecture of ztunnel. So essentially, when ztunnel reaches running, the first thing ztunnel does is going to make a secure connection to the Istio control plane, 15.0.12, and ask, can I get my XDS configuration? And then the Istio control plane is going to come back to say, okay, you are a ztunnel. Here is your XDS configuration. And then the ztunnel is going to come on to you to say, hey, can you give me the search for this particular application A, which is, by the way, located on my node. I want to be able to impersonate that application A. Can you give me the search? Istio control plane is going to check, oh, right, you are allowed to represent the application A. Here's the signed search for application A. So that's how the ztunnel architecture works at a real high level. So when we started looking at ztunnel after the initial announcement, we started to think about, okay, initially when we implemented ztunnel, it was implemented using Envoy proxy. The way we had it in mind is we want to pre-program Envoy by Istio control plane generates Envoy configuration and sending that very large XDS configuration to Envoy. That's why when Envoy comes up as a ztunnel, it's pre-programmed, so it knows what to do through that very, very large and complicated XDS configuration. Honestly, only 2 or 3 people on the whole entire Istio project can interpret for ztunnel back then. So that's when September, when we released last year of Ambient. Yuwa, who is our chief architect at Solo, for a while, he's been saying, you know, Envoy configuration is not meant for people, it's meant for machines. So that goes back to, you know, why most people won't be able to understand, particularly when using Envoy for ztunnel. The ztunnel itself needs to represent all the co-located parts, so it's even more complicated than the sidecar case. This is a slide I steal from Rob Salmon. He gave at IstioCon 2021 about Envoy configuration. So the moment you open up any of the Envoy configuration, you'll see it's multiple sections, and it's very, very complicated to read. So from a project perspective, the Istio project was thinking, you know, that's coming back to the drawing board, right? Is Envoy the right proxy for ztunnel? So we started thinking within the community, what if we just send the absolutely necessary configuration down to the ztunnel? What if, you know, we reduce all the network bandwidth from the network traffic between ZOD to ztunnel? Just doesn't necessarily program like ztunnel to do exactly what needs to do, but having ztunnel be able to think out based on what's the necessary configuration sent to ztunnel and then figure out the right thing to do. So by doing that, we're going to kind of dramatically reduce the traffic, the configuration sent from the control plane down to the data plane. So that's the thing we were thinking, started thinking and challenging, you know, is Envoy the right solution? So we started thinking about, you know, what is the necessary configuration needed for ztunnel if we're not implementing ztunnel using Envoy? So we started to think about, okay, ztunnel needs to know all the co-located workflow detail, right? Because we don't want to have ztunnel, you know, talk to the Kubernetes API server to be able to get all the co-located workload information. So it needs to know, like, what are the workloads running, you know, what namespaces they are on, are they using what service account, you know, what's the status, are they ready, what's the IP address, is it able to handle the edge phone protocol so that we know whether we can send encrypted edge phone traffic to it. Does it have waypoint proxy, right? Because we always need to think out what is the next stop after the ztunnel. Does it have any layer for authorization policy, for example, for the workload? What is the corresponding service information? So these are all the information ztunnel needs to know. But wait, there's actually more, because ztunnel not only needs to handle the co-located workloads, it also needs to figure out in the next hop, and the next hop could be on a different node. So it actually needs to know all the workloads detail for the entire Kubernetes system. And in addition to that, the workloads can be inside of your Kubernetes, and the workloads can also be maybe outside of the mesh sphere inside of your Kubernetes, or maybe the workloads can even be running on the VM. So these are the necessary configurations for ztunnel. So this is how we come up with the workload XDS inside of the community to be able to represent the right, absolutely necessary configuration from the control plane down to the ztunnel. So basically, as you add in your workloads, by the way, you can add your workloads to Ambient through label, by label your namespace with istio.io data plane mode Ambient. So the moment you add that, the istio D control plane would recognize the workloads for that particular namespace and mark it as XPhone for the protocol, which is what you see highlighted on the screen. And the moment if you deploy any policy, in this case, it will be an authorization policy. Istio D control plane would send the policy down to the ztunnel in the mesh, and then be able to associate the authorization policy for that workload, refer to the particular authorization policy that you applied. So this really comes down to a much simplified XDS configuration from the control plane to the data plane, right? So it's very simple to read and debug, which I'm going to show you guys in a little bit. Oh, by the way, how many of you are in the Istio workshop this morning? Istio and Istio Ambient? Okay, awesome. A few of you. Good to know. And then we talk about much less resource from Istio D to actually from Istio D as a control plane. It needs less CPU and memory now because it doesn't need to generate the humongous XDS configuration for ztunnel. It's also, we talk about reduced network costs between ztunnel and Istio D to send to all the ztunnel because there's much reduced configuration. So that is the configuration protocol, right, from the control plane to data plane. The next thing we look at, right, is we're not necessarily using Envoy, you know, how we want to implement ztunnel. So we actually tried different processes in the community. We tried Golang implementation of ztunnel, but it wasn't performing as well as we wanted. We also looked at C++ implementation. And then we started thinking, you know, that maybe close to Envoy proxy, which is also C++. And we We finally decided on Rust because of the general industry trend regarding Rust for high performance and low utilization for proxy, and also very, very battle tested and very nice library for us to use for the async runtime, such as Tokyo and Hyper libraries, which we use for HTTP. And last not the least is Envoy doesn't support work stealing, and Rust can support work stealing very easily through its Tokyo library. Throughout the architecture of ztunnel, we felt work stealing is very important because the fact that ztunnel needs to open up connections to multiple other ztunnels to be able to have work stealing as an important scheduling for ztunnel to be able to reuse the connection and workload. All right, so that is ztunnel. A lot of changes went into to make ztunnel simpler. Let's talk about waypoint. Neeraj talked about waypoint briefly from September to now. One of the changes we introduced regarding waypoint is not only you can run waypoint for a particular service attempt, now you can also run a waypoint for your namespace. So if you feel namespace is the right tenancy model for you, you could just run waypoint proxy for your namespace instead of running for each individual service account within your namespace. So that's number one. You can continue to run waypoint for your service account like previously. You can easily create your waypoint proxy using the Istio Pado experimental waypoint command to generate the waypoint YAML or apply command to apply the waypoint to your Kubernetes cluster, and then the Istio-D is going to automatically help you spin the waypoint proxy for you. The important thing is making sure, you know, to check the gateway class name is your waypoint for waypoint, and it's typically config to listening on port 15008, which is the port the edge phone is listening on. This was an example of creating a waypoint proxy for your namespace. Notice I didn't specify any service account. If you do want to create your waypoint proxy for a given service account, what you do is apply this annotation. You can apply this --/ service account, which would transform to the annotation to say this is the waypoint proxy for a given service account. All right, so that's how you create a waypoint. Let's take through quickly on how waypoint proxy works. So essentially, as a user, you would run kubectl apply command with the generated waypoint configuration. By the way, which this is represented as the new Kubernetes Gateway API resource. Alternatively, you can use the Istio-Pado experimental waypoint command to deploy the gateway resource representing your waypoint. After Istio control plane sees the waypoint resource, Istio control plane is going to say, let me automatically deploy the waypoint proxy based on what's described in the gateway resource. And as waypoint comes up, the waypoint proxy is going to establish a secure connection to Istio control plane on port 15012, which, by the way, is just exactly the same as the sidecar today, and say, hey, this is my Istio token. Can I get my cert signed? And the Istio control plane is going to say, hey, your token is valid. Here are the signed certs. And then the waypoint proxy is going to ask, can I get my latest XDS configuration? By the way, the waypoint is still implemented using Envoy proxy because Envoy proxy is the number one high-performance Layer 7 proxy out there, and the job of the waypoint is to handle Layer 7 processing, so we'll continue to leverage Envoy in there. And then Istio control plane is going to come back, hey, this is your Envoy XDS config, So that's essentially how the waypoint proxy works. So after we ship Ambient in September, we started to think about how we can make waypoint simpler, right? So we have a waypoint proxy, we have an Istio control plane. So we started to ask ourselves, the waypoint configurations are very complicated, also very complicated to read back then. So we started to ask, how can we simplify the configuration? So the map we're looking at right now is a typically Envoy proxy, right? It's connecting to all other potential services inside or outside of the mesh, right? So typically in Istio, how many of you actually use Istio export to and sidecar resource? For some of you using Istio in production, you probably know that it's very, very critical in Istio land to be able to make sure the sidecars are only having the absolute necessary configuration. So typically you would apply these two configurations to make sure your sidecar is self-contained to only the necessary configuration. So in this simple example, we have red, purple, orange, and blue, right? So each of them are seeing everybody else. And the moment you apply export to annotation, in this case, to the red service or as a service producer, you're saying, you know, I'm only applying this to my current namespace and the issue ingress, and then the purple sidecar and blue sidecar would not be able to see it. And as a service consumer, in this case, you can apply the sidecar resource. Right, you can apply to the sidecar resource that configure your egress traffic. So the moment you apply that, you would further limit the visibility of the configuration for the red and the orange sidecar, which is nice, right? Because we talk about how Envoy configurations are huge. In this case, it would be dramatically limit what it will contain. And similarly, if you apply similar sidecar resource on namespace 2, you are further reduce the configuration, right? So we start to ask ourselves, you know, how should we do something similar for waypoint proxy, right? Should we introduce export 2 and sidecar configuration to waypoint proxy? Sounds nice, but it requires users to manually configure that, right? Because at the end of the goal, you know, we want to make sure the waypoint proxy only contains what's absolutely necessary without user to manually configure anything, right? So we started looking at, I think Niraj mentioned this briefly, what if we just introduce a destination-only waypoint proxy, right? If you think about the waypoint is only for the particular service account or for the particular namespace, right? So essentially, waypoint pretty much knows every single target, either within the service account or within the namespace, right? So by having a destination-only focused waypoint proxy, waypoint proxy only needs to handle destinations, clusters, the endpoints, and routes, so and doesn't need to worry about everything else inside of the cluster, so that really dramatically simplifies the waypoint proxy. And what's even interesting when we take that approach is we no longer need to ask any of our users to configure export to and sidecar, like what they have doing for the sidecar today, the sidecar architecture today. So that's really nice. So this is the experimental we did to calculate waypoint configurations by default, right? So in this case, we envision that between the sidecar architecture and the ambient architecture with waypoint, which is on the second row, that with each of the two namespaces, each of them have 25 deployments, each deployment with 10 pods, and each waypoint deployment also have high availability with 2 points. The configuration distribution from to the sidecar I would say, I guess on the other the waypoint configuration compared with the sidecar configuration on distribution is 0.0 0.8%, right? So in other words, the sidecar configuration is 100 times. It's a little bit more than 100 times, but my math is not doing very well. But you get the idea, right? It has 100 more configurations than the waypoint proxy. So what does this mean? This means you're going to save a lot on CPU and memory, right, on your waypoint compared with the sidecar. This also means there's much reduced configuration network costs from the Istio control plane to the waypoint proxy. All right, egress waypoint. So this is something I don't want to give you a lot of information because it's really under construction in the community. But the idea is we will allow you to be able to config egress traffic that goes outside of your namespace, goes outside of your service account for you, but it's going to be declaratively. So it's not going to be, you know, automatically we envision you'll be able to reach everything else in the NICE. So you're going to declaratively tell us through configuration YAMLs, and then we will program the waypoint accordingly to do that. All right, let's get to the demo. If the demo gods are with me, looks like I have my environment now. I know the Wi-Fi is not very good. So the first thing, what I'm going to do, by the way, I have a Kubernetes cluster deployed. I should already have Ambient installed. So you can see I have a four-node cluster. I have a ztunnel deployed on each of the nodes. I also have Istio CNI. I also have Argo rollout, Argo CD installed. I also have Istio control plane, Istio gateway deployed. I have Kayali and Prometheus installed. All right, so let's make this bigger. Can you guys see it? Is this big enough? All right, thank you. So the first thing I'm going to do is label my default namespace with Ambient, right? We talk about how easy it is to add your pods to Ambient. You don't have to drag the sidecar anymore, right? So the second thing I'm going to do is deploy the sleep application to the default namespace. So the sleep application is just a simple container that you can run curl commands. So think about it as a client. And the next thing what I'm going to do is I'm going to do a port forward, let me make this a little bit bigger, to the Argo CD server. This is for the purpose for me to allow myself to access the UI. So I just feel that I can deploy a Kubernetes application into my Ambient, right? Have it added to Ambient. Now I'm going to add my application through Argo application to Ambient. So what I'm going to do is create this application and give a simple project name, and I want to set sync policy to be automatic because I don't want to manually sync every single time. And now I'm going to point to my GitHub repository, and the path is going to be hello world. So it's just a simple repository. Let me show you guys really quickly. So it's a simple repository that has a gateway virtual service configuration for Hello World. It has a rollout template and also a rollout analysis template. So we can go through the detail after I kick off this application. So we're just going to deploy in the default namespace, which I have the Ambient label enabled. Let me double check, make sure everything looks good. Go ahead, create the application, right? So what this is going to do is deploy the Argo application to my Kubernetes cluster to the default namespace. And because the fact I already labeled that namespace with Ambient, so it's going to deploy Hello World automatically into Ambient. And so in this case, I'm not deployed using Kubernetes deployment YAML. I'm deployed using this Argo rollout customer resource by Argo. Well, I say, let's go ahead and deploy Hello World. By the way, this is an Istio example. Let's go ahead and deploy Hello World container. And if you do have multiple versions of Hello World, which we will try shortly, this is the rollout plan where we want to do 25 waves, 50 and 75 with the Istio success rate, the analysis template. So this is our analysis template where we define the success criteria by looking at the response code of our premises. All right, so looks like I have the Hello World application running. So let me just double check on that. Okay, so I have sleep and the Hello World. The next thing I'm going to do is go to terminal here. I'm going to generate some node. So what this does is from sleep to Hello World, you know, we're going to incur the request. And now if I go to the Kayali dashboard, I should hopefully be able to see some graphs. So I'm going to try to do that. Set the namespace to default. All right. Looks like it's going to take a little bit of time. Let me click on refresh. So it might take a little while. So I'm going to come back to the Kayali board. But in the meanwhile, I am going to get the ztunnel pod information. So let me go ahead and set ztunnel to one of the ztunnel pods. And I'm going to dump out the workload XDS configuration from this particular ztunnel. So what does this show? This essentially shows what the ztunnel is getting from the control plane, right? Remember we talked about how we want to simplify workload XDS configuration. Is it too small? Yeah, exactly. That's the point I want to show you. It's like you don't have to look up the Envoy configuration to understand this configuration, right? You can see this is my sleep pod name. This is it sleeps Ashbone as the protocol, and it's a deployment. You know, it's running on this node. It's healthy. Yeah, that's the whole purpose of the redoing ztunnel so that you can understand it without going through any product documentation. All right, let me go back to my Kayali board. I do have Hello and Sleep now. Let me go ahead and turn on the animation. So look, basically I label my namespace. Now I'm getting observability. I'm getting mutual tiers between my pods. And I'm not changing anything of my pods, right? That's the power of Ambient, right? You remember, we are still running without sidecar, right? So the only thing we did is just simply label the namespace. All right, so let's go ahead and try version 2 of Hello World. The first thing we're going to do is we're going to generate the waypoint configuration. That's only for you to look at the configuration. The next thing we're going to do is apply the waypoint proxy to the default namespace. So notice I didn't specify any service account, so this means I'm applying a waypoint proxy for the entire namespace. So you can see my waypoint proxy is running. So this is the Envoy-based. What I'm going to do next is I want to roll version 2 of my Hello World, right? So I'm going to use auto rollout to say, hey, go ahead and set the image to version 2. And I can start to check out my rollout status. You can see the rollout status is kicking off. Let me make sure. On this side, I expect to see traffic to gradually shift to version 2. Initially, we should see 25%. Remember the Argo template, not the template, I'm sorry, the rollout configuration with that, right? It will be 25%. If it all goes well, we're going to get 50% and 75% to version 2. So if we go back to our demo, looks like we are getting more of the version 2. So what I'm going to do is do another rollout status. You can see we're getting to 50% now. So in fact, you can actually see the virtual service being used right now. So if I do adapt virtual service, you can see it's 50% to stable and 50% to canary. which is version 2. So this is how I want to show you how easy it is to have Ambient work with the existing CI/CD system if you're using. By the way, how many of you use the auto rollout today? A few of you? Excellent. All right, so now we have stable is coming to 25% and canary is getting to 75%. So, wait, I think we might roll out. Let's see. Let me double check. All right, okay, yeah, because we'll roll out already finished, so we should be able to see everything goes to Hello World version 2 very soon. Let me double check on the pod. Okay, I guess one of the pods hasn't winding down yet. That's probably why. All right, the next thing I want to show you is I want to show you the waypoint configuration simplification, but I still have a little bit of time. So so what I'm going to do is deploy HTTP beam, which is another sample we use in the Istio project, and also its virtual service and gateway resource in the HTTP beam namespace. And then I want to show you the waypoint configuration in the default namespace. So even though I deploy HTTP in a different namespace, it's part of the it's part of the Kubernetes system. But from the cluster configuration and the route configuration of the waypoint proxy, it doesn't know anything about that, right? So that's the waypoint configuration simplification we talk about, right? You don't have to manually configure anything to tell us. It's automatically configured with the destination-oriented waypoint proxy. Oh, the last thing I want to show is you can easily delete your waypoint, right? Like in my scenario, I'm only using a waypoint to roll out a newer version of version 2, right? When the version 2 is automatically rolled out successfully, right? I don't need the waypoint. I can delete it and I'm not paying the cost of waypoint. This is another powerful thing about Ambient that you only pay for the cost that you need. With that, I'd like to ask if you guys have any questions. I think, go ahead. Can you repeat it? Say it a little bit louder. Oh, okay, great question. So the question is, how is the user probe in their Kubernetes application work with Ambient, right? So I believe it's actually very similar to sidecar, right? In the sidecar world, the probe is you can config traffic redirection to be captured or not captured by the sidecar, right? So in Ambient, we would automatically capture your probe by default because we capture all the traffic incoming and outgoing unless you program and tell us not to, unless there's an issue. Yeah, right. But by default, we would capture all the incoming and outgoing for you. Yes. Yeah, it should be automatically captured unless you, unless like there is the incompatibility issues with your application that you explicitly config to be opt out of the capture. Yeah. That's a great question. Yeah. Yeah, so the mutual TLS, you're asking about the mutual TLS termination, right? So the question is the mutual TLS termination on the ztunnel architecture diagram, which is this one, is it automatically terminated on the destination ztunnel? Yes. So essentially, this particular ztunnel would establish the mutual TLS, the HTTP2 tunnel, if the destination is also in 10 speed accept the HTTP HTTP, right? That's how it works. If the destination is outside of the MAC, it would send the plain text traffic. Oh, yeah. I think that, yeah, we are a little bit out of time, so I am going to go ahead and wrap it up. And the one last slide I want to show you before I wrap up is we've done, actually, Greg and my team has done a little bit of analysis of resource savings. He did a simple experimental 3 deployments can replicate each in his small Kubernetes cluster. And you can see the first diagram is CPU, compare sidecar with Ambient, ztunnel, and also Ambient ztunnel and waypoint. So you can see sidecar is using a lot more CPU and memory compared with just ztunnel. Even compared with the waypoint, sidecar is still using more because you can't choose the number of replica of your sidecar, right? If your deployment is 10, your sidecar is 10, but with waypoint, you could potentially run 2 or 3. So with that, I want to say you definitely can see over 90% saving and could be even more on large deployments when you just use layer 4. And, you know, when you use layer 4 and layer 7, you definitely are going to see also a good chunk of saving. We're predicting 75% or even more. All right, sidecar is going to be here today. I think one of you specifically asked a question about, you know, source-side specific configuration. In that case, we do expect you continue to use sidecar if you need a particular source-side configuration overrides on that. With that, I'm going to thank you, and I believe we have Yuval next to talk about eBPF, connection tracking, ztunnel upgrades, eBPF acceleration, and redirection. So please join me. Welcome, Yuval.